Hello everyone, my name is Su Nil Hwang and I'm from Dongguk University, South Korea. And today I'd like to talk about Korean Buddhism, but it's a bit strange because my major field is Sanskrit and Pali. It's an Indic study, but this is about Korean Buddhism. So while I was talking, I will tell you why I'm involved in this kind of things. So Master Seongcheol is among the most famous Zen monk in Korea, contemporary Korea. And he is very powerful and a charismatic leader residing in Haeinsa Temple. And also he's very nice, how can I say, preacher delivering Dharma talk. When he was delivering Dharma talk, everyone silent. Some of them sleeping, but usually very powerful, you know, Dharma talk he usually gave. And I was involved in Seongcheol's book mainly because when I did my PhD in Oxford, Korean economy was in crisis. In 1999, we are under IMF control, and the money exchange rate going, you know, up and up and up. So at that time, I actually get the funding from White Lotus Foundation. That's the Baekje Hermitage where Master Seongcheol resided there. So when I coming back, Baekje Hermitage asked me, you should do something. So I said to them, okay, then I will translate one of his most important book, as I understand. That was a sermon of 100 days. It's a Baekilbeomun. And when I talk about it to Lord Boswell, he said to me that you should put the subtitle, a Zen master or Zen master look at Buddhist philosophy. Because in Korea, usually Zen master never read any text. They just sit down and do the meditation. But he's exceptional. He's exceptional. And this sermon of 100 days is based on recording of his morning sermon during the summer and winter retreat in 1967, celebrating his appointment as a head monk in the Haeinsa Temple. So this is a Korean version, become very popular. But I have to say, when they compile this Korean version, they change everything. Quite a lot, because I saw the original recording and the note and the final outcome. Many people changed it, a bit disappointed, but they tried to make sense of it, because original teaching during the late 1960s sometimes not really, you know, follow with the, you know, the outcome of a modern Buddhist scholarship. So I did for 4 years translating this book into English version with Linda Corbin. She is my colleague in Oxford. So she changed my Korean Southeast dialect called the Gyeongsangdo English into Porsche Oxford English, and revised by my supervisor Richard Gombrich. He actually read everything and the comment everything, and finally we got the outcome. So My supervisor visited Korea, I think year 2008, and we read together the introduction part of the Baekilbeomun. And there, Venerable Seongcheol said, Buddhist aims at becoming awakened, and this cannot be achieved through the study of doctrine and of things alone, not even the greatest scholars. And what then is the purpose of Tipitaka, a Buddhist canon? And my supervisor pays become dead because he was not happy with this kind of attitude. You know, but Venerable Seongcheol, he was concerned about Buddhist text because Haeinsa is famous for this library where we have 84,000 woodblock. So Master Seongcheol cannot ignore the Dharma tradition in Haeinsa Temple. So he tried to explain all those Dharma things in accordance with his own, you know, Zen or meditation idea. I was once very lucky to get inside to there. I have a chance to have a loving with my supervisor. And this is my treasure number one in my office in Dongguk University. So Master Seongcheol continued, and he said, reading and the learning of a Buddhist canon or text it's entirely wasting of your time. You know, what should you do? And sit and meditate. What you should do is sit and meditate. So he said, what we should understand, we should realize in the meditation according to Sangchen Sennim in the book, is realizing the middle path. So middle path cannot be realized through knowledge or wisdom based on language and text. It can only be realized through the mind within the deep contemplative meditation. That's the basic position of a Korean Zen Buddhist monk. So he gave a simile. A visitor to Nepal will need a guidebook. In it, it will find a description of how beautiful Himalayan mountains are. Such a book could persuade the traveler to visit there, filling him with a desire to see it for oneself, which means Buddhist textual tradition could be like writing a travel guidebook, like you know, Lonely Planet. So all the Buddhist scholar do is commenting on, you know, Lonely Planet, and so that makes me makes him really upset. The Gombrich felt very embarrassed because he dedicates all his life in the study of Buddhist tradition, but the outcome is just commenting on the travel guidebook. He actually became very upset. His face almost red, and he was going back, not in a happy mood. But after 3 months, he sent me long email. Quite long, I couldn't read everything. but the point is that he said, a good book about soccer can be written by a person who cannot play soccer at all. So even though he can sit and meditate, but he can explain how it works, how we can, you know, follow, what kind of a rule, what kind of a technique you are using. He actually said this sentence to me, so he's okay. I totally understand your master, you know, after that. So, that experience make me, why a Venerable Sangchal so deep into the idea of meditation? Why he keep saying middle path again and again? So I was checking the whole of his book, and what could be the reason for that. And then I found that this is a Enlightenment Chamber in Dongguk University, Jeonggakwon. There you can see the object of veneration, Shakyamuni Buddha. But while we were there, we were chanting Ha Sutra, maybe 400 or 500 later, you know, composed in India. And the basic Buddhist text for Jogye order in South Korea is Bajra Chedika. And Bajra Chedika cannot be the outcome of a historical Buddha. That's almost impossible. So Venerable Sangchal actually tried to sort it out, you know, kind of identity problem between the center of veneration as a Shakyamuni Buddha and our all Buddhist practice based on Mahayana Buddhist text. That's a kind of key question. Can the Mahayana teaching be the teaching of the historical Buddha? So that's the key issue he was actually trying to answer. So for example, Sadharma Pundalika or Tamsaka, some of the major Buddhist canon in Mahayana tradition, cannot be produced during the time of the historical Buddha. So what can we sort it out? What could be the way we can do it? So he said, in the old days, there hardly was anyone doubted that it was the historical Buddha who taught both early canon as well as Mahayana sutras. Korean Buddhists had long been believed that historical Buddha was responsible for all Mahayana Buddhist sutras. And the reason why we believe it is the Gyosang Pansak, that's the classification of a Buddhist teaching developed in Chinese, Tiantai tradition or Huayan tradition, where they classify. But what they are doing was that, you know, Buddhism developed almost 900 years, 1,000 years. They squeeze it into the 40 years of life of the Buddha. They squeeze it in there, and then explaining every Mahayana Sutra in that category. So it's called the Five Period and Eight Doctrines. So the outcome was that the first teaching of the Buddha was not the Four Noble Truths delivered in the Sarnath in India. The first teaching delivered was Avatamsaka, you know, during the 21st day, just after the enlightenment, he going up to the heaven and delivering Hua Yan teaching. It's very similar to Southern Buddhist tradition, where we said 3 weeks after the enlightenment, Buddha going up to the heaven, and the fourth week, he was just sitting there in a nice jeweled chamber, thinking how to teach Abhidhamma. So in Southern Buddhist tradition, Abhidhamma was actually first teaching of the Buddha. Mm. So that sort of thing actually occurred. So we can actually see that kind of change in the Buddhist mural painting in Korea. So this is a mural painting from Hongguksa temple. And it was called the No-One Jumper. No-One means Ishipatana Migadaya, you know, the deer path of a wise man. But here you can see no deer, no Panchabhagya Bhikkhu. you only see YN teaching, Buddha going up to the heaven delivering, you know, high-end teaching over there. You know, if we go to India, the first teaching usually expressed like this in an iconic way. Chakra, Dhamma Chakra, empty seat, Dhamma Buddha Pada. So Buddha was actually sitting here delivering the first sermon. Or we have a Gandharan style where we can see the Panchabhagya Bhikkhu, but the symbolism still here, Dhamma Chakra and deer. It looks like a horse, but should be deer. Or when it becomes the statue of the Buddha, we have a nice Buddha delivering first sermon. And you can see here down there, Chakra and Panchabhagya Bhikkhu, or Thai mural painting, usually very nice. In Korea, around the 14th century, when I checked it, they usually have a No-One Jumper halfway in between actual Panchabhagya Bhikkhu with the Buddha and the Hua Yan teaching. But here as well, the hand gesture, it's not teaching gesture, it's a Bhumi Sparasya Mudra, not the teaching hand gesture. And slightly later, you have a very small section down there, and the big section upper there. And this one, putting into the corner, putting into the corner. And finally, about late 1700, totally disappeared. It looked like, I'm not sure. It's become very unimportant. And the Bairojana or Huayan become very important. So compared to the Korea, a situation in Japan is a lot better because we have a Tominaga Nakamoto, who was excellent scholar, but very poor family. So when he was young, he was working for the library in Tojisha Temple in Nara, and then he starting to read the Mahayana Buddhist text, and then he concluded this kind of a complex teaching cannot be produced just once. It should be accumulated. Someone do this, someone do this, someone do this. So the outcome of Mahayana teaching might be takes a long, long time with so many people involved. So he was actually kicked out from the temple, and he died very early, at the age of 29, very early. But Japan was different, but Korea still there. So when I was accepted to the Oxford University, my mother wanted me to meet some of the very leading Korean monk in the Jogye Order. And he asked me, what are you going to study? So I said to him, I'd like to study Abhidhamma Kosha Bhasha, Pali Tipitaka. And he said to me, Pali Tipitaka, Abhidhamma Kosha Bhasha, the Buddha wrote when he was very young. Intelligence very low. You shouldn't study there. And he said to me, you should study either Hua Yan or Sadharma Kundalika. That's the core teaching of the Buddha. So this kind of idea is still going on, even nowadays in Korea. So the idea that my Mahayana text could no longer be regarded as the word of the Buddha provoked a wide range of disputes in Buddhist society. Moreover, modern scholars, you know, not just Mahayana, Hinayana as well, you know, until the 5th century in Sri Lanka, we keep changing it, you know, in the Pali canon. So then very strangely, Venerable Master Songchul, quoting from Japanese Buddhist scholarship, Ui Hakuju, very famous scholar of Buddhism Indian philosophy department in Tokyo University, and he presenting three principles to identify core teaching of the Buddha, and Venerable Sungchul accepted, and he openly talk about this in the Dharma talk. That's a kind of a very, how can I say, dangerous move, because 1960 in Korea we have an anti, you know, social movement against the Japanese tradition. The Park Chung-hee regime tried to have a contract with Japan, and everyone demonstrating against that. So I think it actually gave me quite surprising. Oh, the 1960s, Venerable Sungchul accept Japanese Buddhism, made me so strange. So as I reading through his book, I feel like he thought, even though it is outcome of Japanese Buddhism, it's very important to justify the identity crisis in Korean tradition. So they actually keep going. I will making faster. So he follow with the principle, the fundamental teaching of the Buddha could be the declaration of a middle way. So middle way is the teaching of the Buddha. So any Mahayana teaching which follow the middle way principle is Buddha's teaching, is Buddha Vajana. So that's the conclusion of Venerable Sungchul. So that book, Baekgyulbom Mun, the whole Buddhist tradition from India to Korea, he interpreted it in terms of a middle path, so that all the teaching become the word of the Buddha. You know, that's the Sungchul's you know, a way to do. But I have to say the middle path in early canon, Dhammacakka Pavattana Sutta, is a middle path between asceticism, middle path between asceticism and secular life. But Sungchul's middle path different. He usually talk about water and fire, good and evil, light and wrong, being non-being, suffering and happiness, you and me, sometimes mountain and water, you know, that kind of anything, you know, we can make it a pair, it's too extreme. So what we should do is going in the middle. And people asked me, what is the middle path? And Sungchul said that in order to understand that, you should sit down and meditate. It only recognized through the meditation, you know. So I just skip here. So Mahayana teaching could be regarded as a word of the Buddha, and as a middle path is acknowledged as a fundamental teaching of the Buddha. Mahayana tradition could be regarded as a word of the Buddha. So this is so far, far more important than anti-Japanese sentiments during the time. So there are many people actually criticizing Master Sungchul. He was not really you know, correct. Sometimes he over-interpret. Sometimes he talks something a bit silly, and so on. So when I think about the situation, this is my simile for the Sungchul's situation. A grandson visiting his grandfather, pounding him, listening to music over very old radio set with a static noise. So the son said to the grandfather, why don't you throw this radio set away? I will buy you a new one. And the son said to him, grandfather said to son, are you listening to the noise? I'm listening to the music. So kind of a interpretation of old master, he's not trained as a, you know, kind of a scholar, doing some philology or and so on. But we try to, you know, try to make some kind of a view over him in terms of a modern, you know, philological scholarship. And I think that is just like a static noise. We focusing on static noise. We are not focusing on the music. So Sungchul is trying to deliver the truth according to his own experience. So I think if we really want to understand why Sungchul did something like that, we should be in his position and try to listen what he was talking about. So if you grasp the gist of his thinking, you could also arise above the world of contradiction and confrontation and join him with the music of the Buddha. That is my final thought on the middle path, diversely interpreted by Master Sanchin. Thank you very much.